sins of the young and bright faculty members, students, and our invitees from the schools. This is the third occasion of my participating in these kinds of festivals organized by the students. First one was in Kanpur IIT, then Bombay IIT, and now here. Amazing that the second year, third year students are organizing such mammoth festivals with the faculty standing by them, maybe guiding them. From yesterday evening, I have been seeing our young friends doing everything meticulously. So let me first compliment all the organizers for this effort. This is a pristine institute, pristine campus, but you can see the level of detail that one has gone through in planning this building and executing this building. Right from the place where I stayed to this hall, it is visible. So let me also compliment the founder director. There could be many directors of an institute, but it is a rare opportunity for someone to become a founder director. And why it is so? Because you create from nothing, number one. Number two, you decide the direction and the culture that the institute will continue to have. And it will be difficult for the posterity to make much of alteration if you have put a firm footing. So this is something which one gets rarely in the life, and we have seen some with that opportunity, and the young faculty members who could be mistaken for doctoral students of this institute. Thank you very much. The subject that I chose today for the talk is Strides in Science for the Indian Space Endeavour. First and foremost, it is IISER. You stand fundamentally for science. What I wanted to convey first is science and engineering have to go hand in hand. It's an amalgam of science and engineering that make wonders. If there is an engineer who does not appreciate the importance of science, he or she will not understand the how and why of what they are doing. If the scientist does not appreciate the importance of engineering, I am sure they can do theoretical physics, but if you have to make an instrument and fly it, if you have to make an instrument and use it, that skill is to be appreciated, and that is essential. Even in the area of space, if you see the early founders of the program, they were scientists. They also understood what is involved in making an instrument. They made instruments. And in the course of this lecture, I will give some of those examples. So this is an important element. And what I'm trying to tell today, can I have it? Is in the space program, when we talk about the missions, the launch vehicle, satellites, or even the planetary mission, or the applications, or the new technology, what is the role of science in that? And first and foremost, we have the designation for our people as scientist / engineer. I don't know who devised this. And knowing the vision of the founders, like Sarabhai, like Professor Dhawan, there must be something to it when one national laboratory calls some scientists, another major institution called them scientific officers. Here they decided to put the word scientist and engineer. In a simple analysis, one can say that yes, you require both scientists and engineers, so you have got a designation which is common to all. But the deeper meaning of that is, in space, we cannot do a thing without appreciating both science and engineering. Next. You be here. Put a chair. These are familiar pictures for you. The first one is the household name today, PSLV. And you will see almost every month now a launch taking place carrying Indian satellites and foreign satellites. The next one is our GSLV, much talked about for a few years for the failures that we went through, but it is doing well today. And on September 8th, we have a launch of a meteorological satellite using this GSLV with our own cryogenic stage. It is the third successful flight, if it becomes a success, of the Indian cryogenic stage. And the next one is India's advanced launcher. We call it LVM3. What is more important for any launch vehicle is what is the mass that it can put in an orbit. And what is the accuracy of injecting that mass, that is a satellite, into the orbit? Also, we talk about how reliable it is, how safe it is in operation, how versatile that launcher is. Now, if you look at the PSLV, GSLV and LVM3, comparison on a leg-to-leg basis, the mass it can put into an elliptical orbit of 200 into 36,000 kilometers. We call it geostationary transfer orbit. It is 1,300 kg approximately for PSLV. It's about 2,000 kg plus for GSLV. And when the LVM3 is going to be in service, it is going to be 3,000 to 4,000 kilogram. That is one aspect of it. If you look at the total mass of this launch vehicle, the PSLV, the high-end version of it, will weigh 320 tons at the launch pad, the lift of mass. The GSLV would be around 420. And the LVM3 would be about 640 tons. So PSLV to LVM3 is doubling of the lift of mass of the vehicle. But if you look at the payload that it puts, it is 1300, here it is 3000 to 4000. Obviously, the advanced launch vehicle is a more efficient vehicle. And if it can carry larger, heavier mass to the orbit, certainly the cost per kilogram of putting a satellite into that orbit is going to come down. This is in general about these three launch vehicles. But if you look at what is that science, what is the mathematics, physics, or chemistry that is behind building these rockets, that is interesting. I said first, the test is the mass that it can carry to an orbit. And you all know about the escape velocity. If you look at the mass to be carried to an orbit, the first and foremost thing is the propulsion, the power to take this mass up. And for each orbit that you talk about, something will be let us say 500 kilometers above Earth, something would be 200 by 36,000 of that time. You require a specific energy to put them into that orbit. And that energy is provided by the chemical propulsion, which is in the form of solid propellants, a fuel and an oxidizer and some additives, or liquid propellants, which are either earth storable or the cryogenic ones. There will be an oxidizer, there will be a fuel. The solid propellants are handled, processed well before it is assembled into the rocket. We can store it, we can find out its properties, and we can go with the level of confidence for the launch. When it comes to the earth storable liquid fuels, you fill them up as the rocket is ready to take off, but it contains a lot of fluid control components. In a PSLV, it will be 150 fluid control components that have to function well. And in a GSLV, it would be about 250 such components. You know the problem with a tap in your wash basin or toilet, what happens to it. Similar things happen in a rocket too. So it is more complex to build the rocket to ensure the reliability. But when you talk about cryogenics, you deal with low temperatures. And what is more important is the material that you use for the rocket engine or the fluid circuits must have the property to withstand these low temperatures and also the high temperature that takes place and the combustion is there. It becomes more difficult. It is hydrogen and oxygen at low temperature. The chemist here will know, if you have to ignite them, what difficulty you have. If you have to sustain that ignition, how difficult it is in the rocket. But why do we go for all these three types of systems? There are advantages for its use at the lower stage and for use at upper stage. The first performance indicator is what is called a specific impulse, the thrust that is provided for a given mass flow rate. We express that in terms of seconds. For the solid propellants, which I said are easy to handle, and we can prepare well in advance, it is around 280 plus seconds. But when you talk about the earth storable liquids, it is 300 plus. But the difficult cryogenics when you deal with, it is about 450. That means certainly that gives you more energy for the fuel that you carry. And why don't we use it everywhere? The problems, it is clumsy to handle. For the simple reason I said, we have to maintain these low temperatures. So we define another parameter called density impulse for that. What is the mass to be carried for getting that thrust? And for cryogenics, it is quite low. In a nutshell, what I could say is for the lower stages of the rocket, we go for the solid system, but for the upper stages, we go for the cryogenics. That is the chemistry part of the propulsion. Then we get into the physics of it. All the laws of thermodynamics that you learned here today are all applied when we talk about the combustion part of it, the ballistics part of it. We can find all your rules getting into it to create this system. Materials. I don't make a distinction between chemistry and material science in this aspect. We are very choosy in the material that we use for the rocket, because finally you have to carry all this. So we look for lightweight materials, but which have got higher strength. The materials that could maintain its properties, retain its properties at different ranges of temperatures, high temperature materials, low temperature materials, these are all important for us. Essentially, that is chemistry. And when we talk about self-reliance in rocket technology, that is fundamentally provided by our ability to develop these materials, these chemicals, and produce them in the country. And that is what India has achieved. When we say for the PSLV, the import component is limited to some specific electronic components. All others are produced in the country, developed in the country, as far as the process is concerned, and as far as the capacity is concerned. It comes. We talk about mathematics. Finally, when the rocket is going up, the most difficult part of the journey of the rocket is first 40, 50 kilometers. And all that mass that you are carrying, the 320 tons or 400 odd tons or 640 tons, most of it is used to lift this vehicle, because you know there is a gravity. You know there is a dense atmosphere through which it has to go through. And the rocket is not single body, it is multiple bodies of stages assembled. So it's a very difficult journey. And if you see some of the early rockets that we flew, like ASLV in the 80s, they just broke down. So first and foremost, you have to have the propulsive power, but it has to go through a fast-moving body through the dense atmosphere. There comes the importance of aerodynamics. The object going through a flow field at very high velocities, how it behaves. And as you are going through the accelerating phase, the atmosphere density comes down. There are some points where you will have the product becoming maximum. We call it the dynamic pressure. And that is the most difficult time for a rocket. And if you plan for events during that period, you are likely to get into difficulty. And that is what we learned in the flight tests of ASLV. So we ensure in PSLV and GSLV, etc., we go with the first stage itself, passing through all these difficult phases. And if you look at aerodynamics, most of it is mathematics. The Navier Stokes situation, all that you study will get applied there in that area. Then what happens to this body as it moves, as it gets into various forces? And if you have traveled in an aircraft, you will know what you go through there. What the body goes through, whether the structure will have the integrity to go through. And when you have decided a course for the rocket, you try to control what happens to it. These are all the realm of a group of people called flight mechanics specialists. Again, you have to look at the interactions between the structure, the control system, the propulsion, and it is a holistic picture. You have a systemic view of the rocket. It is like a doctor looking at a human body in its totality. So that is essential to be understood and analyzed. And I said at the beginning, mass is one part of it. The second part of it, the accuracy of injection. If you have seen the launches, we will say it was a copybook launch, textbook launch. We specified 600 kilometers plus or minus 35, and we got within 2 kilometers. How that accuracy is achieved and why that accuracy is important. The second part of it, I will come and talk about the satellites. But how we achieve? And this rocket has to navigate itself. There is no external signal given to this rocket from the ground to decide or change its course, which we do for a satellite. The instruments that are kept in this rocket, the gyroscopes and the accelerometers mounted on the body of this rocket at the top, make that measurement with reference to the inertial frame. And students of physics know what is an inertial frame. During the entire journey of this rocket involves heavy amount of computation on board. And there are several flight computers which conduct this kind of exercise on board. Very reliably, with double redundancy, triple redundancy, these calculations are made. And finally, when that 2 kilometer inaccuracy we talk about there, that is the total inaccuracy of the measurement system and also all the software algorithms we have put in the rocket for navigation, that is finding out its position, for guiding the rocket. Engineers talk about translational dynamics. That means I have decided that I should reach there at this point with this velocity, this altitude. But the propulsion forces may be plus or minus what I originally planned. But still I have to reach that target. So I take a route in which I can reach there. Guide it to that target. And finally, if it deviates from its path, control it. Navigation, guidance, control. That entire inaccuracy is today in terms of couple of kilometers. That shows the precision or the accuracy of the instruments that we have for the measurement and the way we have implemented the entire mission. So this is again what goes in an accurate injection of a rocket. So when we say that PSLV is successful, this is what goes behind such a mission. When we talk about the next item, can I have the next slide? These are the typical satellites that ISRO has been making for specific applications. One is communication, second one is navigation, remote sensing, and for the space science experiment. Each one has a requirement to be met. When you talk about the communication satellites, they have to be having the geostationary property. That means it must go through one revolution in 24 hours approximately. That means you will feel that as a stationary object. It is above the equator. And various customers will be there for that precious orbit at 36,000, because communication is a major business. So each country is allotted a parking slot and you have to stay within that slot. You have to stay within the power that you have been assigned to radiate. You have to ensure that the footprint that you are allowed to do, if it is India, you go through the Indian geography. That has to be maintained. You have to look at the frequencies that have been allotted to you. These are all decided internationally and coordinated for all the countries who are in the communication business. But it is essential for us to reach there and then stay at that place. It is like parking your vehicle in a tight parking slot given in a crowded city. When you talk about the navigation satellites, yes, if you are looking at the global navigation, like GPS, we talk about satellites which are all around and you require at least 4 satellites for the calculation. But India decided to have a different strategy. We are having them in the 36,000 kilometer framework. But there you require the position where it is located so that you can get the total coverage of India. But when it comes to remote sensing, There are two requirements. You see the inside pictures. They are from 36,000 kilometers. But they are very broad pictures, essentially for looking at the cloud and other systems. But if you are looking at land remote sensing for cartographic application, if you want to see a bridge or a road or a car, if you want to see a road or a canal, that's the kind of spatial resolution you look for. And if you say that tomorrow I need the picture of this area, you should be able to point that satellite to that place accurately. So one is the pointing accuracy of the satellite. Second one, the instrument that does this imaging must have that kind of a spatial resolution. And if you have to cover the entire globe, it has to be in a polar orbit. That means it has to go between around the north and south poles. But if you want to see what is happening today compared to what was there a few days ago, and if you want to detect the change that is taking place in an object or in a forest or in an agricultural field, you want the same illumination conditions. So it requires a certain geometry, and we call it sun synchronous orbit. So you have to maintain that. That calls for, again, the accuracy of injection. When you talk about space science, it's a different game for Moon and Mars. We'll come to it later. So this is, the orbit is decided by the end application. And the precision with which you have to inject there is, again, dependent on the application that we talk about. Then, when it comes to the orbits, that is where people will appreciate why they studied ellipse or parabola or hyperbola in their maths class. That is where you find the relevance for the Kepler's law. That's what basically gets into, and we have a strong group, they do the orbital mechanics and the flight mechanics part of it. But for a satellite, as I said, for a rocket, it is the mass and accuracy of injection. Here it has to function in that orbit for a long period of time. 5 years, 10 years, 15 years. All the systems should be working well, and it must be in that location. And it has to be facing the harsh space environment. Some satellites are 500 to 1,000 kilometers above Earth, going around the poles. Communication satellites are at 36,000 kilometers above. What is that harshness of this environment? First and foremost, gravity, impact of it from the other planets, Newton's law of gravitation. Influence from all, people talk about between two objects, it can be from different objects. But still you have to maintain that position there. Otherwise, you'll be violating the restrictions imposed by the International Telecommunication Union, and you'll be transgressing into another satellite operator. You know about the radiation belts, the Van Allen radiation belts, inner one and the outer one. So when you talk about a satellite which is going through these belts up to 36,000 kilometers, all electronic systems have to be protected so that you don't change the digital circuits changing their state. So you have a different gate there, and you have to ensure that they are able to withstand that radiation. Hardening is another part of it. Now, when you talk about this satellite sitting there, you have the energy coming from the sun, you have to have a thermal management, which is very important. And if you look at some of our satellites in the past, the failure has been due to this thermal issues there. And finally, the sun, the solar winds, the solar flares, the 11-year cycle that take place, they have their impacts on the satellites. And also, you have to do a station keeping operation to ensure that it is on course. But many other things can be anticipated, estimated. Some of them are beyond. So we have to keep a vigil of all these things. So these are the difficulties basically in handling a satellite in a tough space environment. And if you look at the deep space, vacuum, it is almost 1 trillion times lower than what you see at the laboratory in which you test this equipment. We call it the standard room condition. So we have to go through a cycle looking at what it is going to go through in terms of temperature and vacuum in the orbit. We call it space simulation. So first you must be having a proper idea of what environment it is going through, and then you have to adequately ensure that in the design, in the construction, in the testing phase, we have gone through it. And these are all the learning of decades, what our people have got. Next one. This is our next phase. We talk about the space exploration. So far it was a major of engineers and minor from the science. But here we talk about an area where the front seat is taken by the mathematicians, by the physicists. If you look at the three objects that we have depicted here, the Earth, the Moon, Mars, and the Sun, of course, there. Indian scientific community have interest in looking at all this. Earth as a total system. One can look at a picture of a car, or one can look at a forest. That is one aspect of it. And later I will come to how you look at Earth as a total system. But if you look at Moon, we had the interest, and we did that in the year 2008, the first lunar mission. But what we did later is very well documented, Mars orbiter mission. We have an astrosat, and if you have gone through the papers, the first Indian paper using astrosat data has been published by Ayuka Puni. That is a contribution by India to the astronomic community of India and the world. Now, what was the challenge that we went through in Mars orbiter mission? Essentially, this is the learning that we had over more than 300 days. We launched satellites using PSLV. We did that. But that launch was different. Because for a minimum energy transfer from Earth to Mars, we needed to ensure certain conditions for the injection in the orbit. Students of mathematics and physics know the 6 orbital elements that you specify, the size and shape of the orbit, the orbital plane, the inclination, and the longitude of the ascending node. And in this orbit, where that is going to be the argument of the periapsis and the epoch. And in this case, when we were putting into the first orbit around Earth, we needed to also ensure a specific argument of perigee. In simple terms, when a PSLV launches a remote sensing satellite, it takes 20 minutes. But here to get this condition, we had to go for about 47 minutes instead of 20 minutes. Normally, when if you draw the line, if it is at 180 degrees, here we have to go another 90 degrees more for that argument of perigee. So that is the first part of it. If America were to launch a mission to Mars, they will straight away take it to the place from where the journey towards Mars will start. It's almost 2 lakh kilometers. But in our case, we had to go step by step from 20,000 kilometer up. So you will see a lot of small circles, blue circles around the object E. E is Earth on the day of launch, November 5, 2030. But you have two big circles. One is the orbit of Mars, one is the orbit of Earth, and you have to catch two moving fellows together on a particular day. So you have a heliocentric travel of almost 300 days. But what is more important here is, on December 1st, just 3 days before that number that I have shown, we have to inject in a direction anticipating or estimating what are the forces going to come on it during the next 300 days. And if you can calculate that precisely, then we are there. If there are minor errors, we can correct it and do it. The errors are beyond correction, then we lose the mission. But we did that on December 1st morning correctly, and on December 4th, it was out of the sphere of influence of Earth. And here, when you talk about September 24th, the idea was to precisely reduce the velocity and get into the orbit of Mars. But I have given three blocks of what the mathematicians went through, what they learned about during this mission Mars. And finally, after 660 million kilometers of travel, the Mars orbiter spacecraft has to be at 500 kilometers plus minus 50 kilometers. This we should estimate well in advance to capture that orbit precise. We were able to do that. So for this mission, the mathematics people guided us for this entire journey. Next. These are some of the things happening now. The latest one, just last week, was an air breathing propulsion module, scramjet module, that was tested on a small rocket. Before that, we had the technology demonstrated flight of reusable launch vehicle. And December 2014, we had the crew module taken on the LBM-3, brought back, went through the re-entry, and it also splashed at the designated point in Bay of Bengal and recovered it. It signifies India's baby steps towards three major directions. And if you look at the effort that has gone behind it, it's easily 20 to 25 years for the last two items. And today, we have got the results as we predicted. And that means we have learned something out of it. Why air breathing propulsion? As I said, we require the propellant and the oxidizer. And if you look at the mass that you carry, almost 85% of it is propellant. And 60% of the propellant is this oxidizer, ammonium perchlorate, or N2O4, or the liquid oxygen that we carry in the rocket. But as it goes through the dense atmosphere, if we can draw the oxygen from the atmosphere and use it for the combustion, then it is advantageous. But it is a very difficult process. the scramjet engine that we had at the given condition of Mach number 6, it opens its stalling and then draws that air at that high velocity. And ignition has to take place there. And as rightly told, in a hurricane you have to light a candle. But we did it. For 7 seconds we were able to sustain that ignition. It's a major technology development. If you look at the reusable launch vehicle, you are all familiar with the word space shuttle. As simple, if you can reuse the same hardware again and again, you reduce the cost of putting a satellite into the orbit. But at the same time, the development of it calls for several new things, and you have to also be clear that before the next launch, it is in a condition to fly. They have done it. Russia did it, but they didn't have an operational program. But in India, we wanted to try out what is involved in that. So this technology demonstrator was a small attempt. Looking at the hypersonic regime of flight, looking at the high temperature materials, looking at the control of a winged body, all that we achieve as predicted. Today, Indian program is unmanned space program. We have not got the capability to put a human being into an orbit, conduct experiment, and bring them back safely. We have certain initial technology demonstrations, and what we did is to have the crew module that we have designed for that particular mission, which can take 2 to 3 crew members. We tried out what happens when the re-entry takes place. And if you know the atmosphere, you know 100 to 120 kilometers above the Earth is a difficult place as the re-entry takes place, where the kinetic energy, something like 7.8 kilometers per second, the object is coming down, and then you have all taking place there because you meet denser air at that time. And the net effect is the heat flux that the body has to go through. Of course, it also depends on the geometry, etc., etc. But this is what we have tested in this system. And we did a similar test in 2007 with another body. So as far as re-entry is concerned, our calculations and what we have seen in these two experiments are almost matching. Why or what it is going to lead to for the future? On one side you have the lunar planetary exploration as one of the targets. There are reasons why the world is looking at Moon, or looked at Moon, world is looking at Mars. There are dreams, today I should say, that we could have habitat in Mars, maybe after several decades. Habitat in Moon. Understanding more about Mars is good to understand about the origin of life on Earth. There are, if you know the cosmology, you will see the kind of metals that are present in many of these planets. And possibly at a future age, you will have planetary exploration plus exploitation of those resources. We need to come back to Earth, we need to bring them back to Earth. So in that context, maybe in a scenario of 40 to 50 years from now, we will be having a program probably by the people on Earth together to have such missions where not only sample, but you may be bringing minerals from the outer planets. Even for a simple mission going to Mars and coming back, many of these technologies would become essential. If you are talking about a low cost, certainly the air breathing is going to help for the future. But a lot of steps have to be taken before we say, yes, these dreams will get translated into concepts that can be demonstrated and concepts that can become operational. It's a long way, long gestation period. Arthur Clarke said somewhere in 1945 that if you put three satellites at 36,000 kilometer, we can have communication. At that time, nobody in the world had the ability to put a rocket at that place, but it was science fiction at that time. But today what we are talking may look fiction, but it may become reality when you people are in the center stage. These are investments, baby steps for the future. Next. Whatever we do in science or engineering must have finally a purpose. Your end goal is not to just publish a paper which some people will read. It must contain a message, a meaning, which maybe at a later stage will become useful for the humanity. Why Indian space program is distinct from the space programs of US or Russia or China and even Japan is exactly that focus. US and Russia in the bipolar world wanted to compete, and space was a medium for competition. If X is going to moon, Y also needed to go to moon. If X could put a satellite into orbit, Y necessarily had to put it. China also followed suit. But from the beginning, the Indian space program has been conceptualized with the objective it must be useful for the people and the society to look at what it can contribute for the development of this country. So finally, that is our thrust. And this is an area in which today India, not only today, even yesterday, India is the role model for the whole world. One country which has brought the fruits of this high technology to the people on the ground. I used to visit Bhopal in the 90s, and my mission was exactly that. How to use remote sensing data for the decentralized planning that is taking place at the district level in the country. How the geologists or the soil conservation department could make use of the imagery to understand about the land and then take measures so that the water can be harvested, soil erosion can be stopped. That is the end goal. If you look at the agricultural fields, can we at least forecast before 1 month of the harvest what is going to be the production this year so that the government could take actions for importing on time? And we have been doing this. And if you have to do this for the agricultural crops, whether it is paddy or wheat or cotton, etc., etc., biologist has to be in the picture. You should know the crop phenology. And the signal that you can pick up from the satellite represents what? How it finally gets into a model which will tell you that this is going to be the yield. If you look at the forest again, different types of forest in the country, we should be able to see that larger picture, synoptic picture from the satellite, correlate with what is happening on the ground. If you want to look at the forest types, if you want to look at the biodiversity at landscape level, which can be seen from the satellite, there comes the importance of a biologist. On the other side, the right side, you will see an important thing which your students of earth science will be worried about. Whether it is monsoon, whether it is weather, whether it is climate, whether it is cyclone. Essentially, it's an interaction between the ocean, the atmosphere, and the land. You require data even to understand this process that is taking place, the coupling between all these that take place. People talk about coupled ocean atmosphere model and bring the orology into it. It requires observations. Some are in situ, but many are provided by the satellite. If you look at the ocean, whether it is sea surface temperature, spatially you can get that information from the satellite. Whereas if you measure in situ, you will get that at points. In-situ measurement can be done also up to 2 kilometers down to 2. But the surface feature spatially can be seen by the satellite. If you look at the roughness of the sea, you can look at, we can derive the wave height, and we can use them not only for predicting or forecasting whether it is safe to travel in the sea or which route you should take. It can also be used for understanding the phenomenon of the weather and climate. Cyclones is very common. And I am sure that there are several students here from the east coast of India. Bay of Bengal accounts for 13% of the cyclones of the world. Sun cyclones, they are generated far deep in the Bay of Bengal near Andaman Nicobar area. All cyclones do not reach the land. Some of them change their course, especially in April, May, you see them. They will come to India, they change the course and go to Myanmar and Bangladesh. Some dissipates there itself. So if you want to know the process of cyclogenesis, if you want to know the process of its advancement and its intensity and track, finally you get into the same thermodynamics. What happens between the ocean and atmosphere. So if you are a student of earth science, you should learn the same Navier-Stokes equation will be used by them, that will be used by the rocket scientist also on this side, and that's the aerodynamics. And if you want to look at the coastal phenomena, again, they will go through the same process. They are fundamentals to be understood. Any student of engineering or science should understand these subjects. The biologists have a new opportunity provided by space. When a human being goes to space, what happens to him or her? Why a special training is required? Why a quarantine is required? What happens to the physiology? What happens to the psychology of the human being after stay in the orbit or in space? We talk about bioastronautics. It's a field of study in which we have not made much progress in the country, but this is what is essential. When we talk about human habitat in Mars or in Moon, comes the next field, astrobiology. So it's a demanding area of research, something where biologists will be finding a place. And finally, before I stop, I just wanted to tell the following. Do not think that when you get a degree, BS or MS from IISER, you have learned everything. We say they teach you how to learn. Be a student throughout your life. Now I am a student, I continue to be a student. Now I am studying cosmology, trying to understand several interesting things. If you get into a profession, if you get into a research after this, then you will know a small percentage of what you have learned over these 4 or 5 years really will be useful at that point of life. There is enough for you to learn. This is the starting point. As you grow in any organization, whether you are teaching or whether you are in any other profession, you will see you have to change the domains. You have to also raise your levels. That means in that domain, you should have wider and wider knowledge. That is one thing which you have to continue to acquire. You continue to be a narrow band specialist, and then you will saturate in that area. So you have to understand, you have to widen your horizon. Widen the domain in which you work. Some people call it business quotient. You all know about IQ. It's an equivalent word here is business. Whatever business you are in, you should know about. Knowing is something, but translating that knowledge into the reality. That is where you should have a separate session with Professor Singh. On the day when he came here and today, how he got the whole thing done. What process he went through So the translation of that requires two. One is you require resources. Second, you require people to do that. You should know how to work with, live with people. And it is not the individual's excellence that matter in your career and profession. It is the collective wisdom. That is where the movie Chak De, you should go and see again and again. How the paranoids from each stage, the captains were brought in together to work as a team finally by your hero, Shah Rukh Khan. That is what is required in a team effort. And how to get the resources mobilized for doing this is important. And the last one is knowing, second one is doing. The most important part of it is being what you are as an individual. What are your guiding value systems? What are your convictions? What is your inner strength as you proceed? If you can imbibe this as you go, acquire this as you go, something you would have got from your parents, something from your teachers, and the people who you deal with in the future, then I'm sure that success will be yours. I wish you all the best for the institute and for all the young bright faces sitting here. And let me also thank the young organizers for inviting me, giving me this platform.